Well, we're joined now by Senator Ted Cruz of Texas, who's also the author of the new book. It's called Unwoke: How to Defeat Cultural Marxism in America. You can see it up on your screen right now. Senator Cruz, thank you so much for joining us here in Counterpoints.
It's great to be with you. Thank you for having me.
All right, so I want to start with a question that you've probably heard from critics. You were on Bill Maher recently on the left over the course of the last couple of months. The book is called Unwoke, again, as we just mentioned. And I'm curious, for example, when Elon Musk banned From the River to the Sea on Twitter, is that an example? Or what do you say to critics who would argue that's an example of conservative wokeness? Do you support banning that from Twitter?
Look, I don't support banning really anything. I believe in free speech. And I think that there's a real difference. It's one of the things I talk about in the book, between the left and the right. The approach of the radical left, the approach of the cultural Marxists, is to use power and force and coercion to silence voices they disagree with. And by and large, conservatives, we're not looking to silence the left. I don't want to see Bernie Sanders or AOC silenced. Frankly, I want to have people hear what they say more because it's so idiotic. Look, I agree with John Stuart Mill. The best cure for bad speech is more speech. And so... But at the same time, we need to understand the reason I wrote this book is what has happened in America. Look, millions of Americans across this country are looking at the state of the nation going, what the heck happened to the country we love? And what has happened is every major institution in America has been captured by the radical left. And what this book does is it explains that. And each chapter in the book focuses on a different institution. So it starts off with universities. I call universities the Wuhan lab of the woke virus. It's where it was created, it's where it mutated, it's where it spread. From universities, the book goes to K-12 education, then to journalism, then to government, then to big business, then to big tech, then to entertainment, Hollywood, TV, movies, music, sports, then to science. And the last chapter in the book focuses on China. And I describe China as a central nexus that is intertwined with all of them. And what the book does is really two things. Number one, it explains how and why these major institutions in America got captured by the radical left. But then even more importantly, it lays out a positive, proactive battle plan for how we take these institutions back. Because I think if we don't take the institutions back, we're going to lose our country.
The taking of these institutions back, though, sometimes seems to people like reverse cancel culture. Like my former colleague Glenn Greenwald has been has become this kind of big supporter of the rights, free speech kind of advocacy over the last several years. And I'm sure you've seen him recently. Yeah. He's been extremely disappointed with the way that the right has responded to the Israel-Palestine catastrophe. Like he wrote, for instance, conservatives pushing this safety rhetoric, which isn't due to violence but words, should either apologize to the minority groups they mocked all these years or realize they're suddenly endorsing such flamboyant victim narratives because a group they like is claiming it. So why hasn't there been more kind of public support for free speech in the last 6 weeks?
So look, I think free speech is the right approach, and I support free speech for everyone. I support it for radicals. I support it for leftists who hate me. I support free speech for Hamas. Now, I also support killing the terrorists so they can have free speech while they're in the grave. But if you engage in acts of terrorism, I emphatically support Israel's right to defend itself and its stated objective that they're going to eliminate Hamas. But when it comes to the U.S., actually what's happening in universities in particular is a powerful illustration of what I explain in this book. It is cultural Marxism. And you know, I've had lots of conversations in the last 2 months, actually with several weeks ago, I was talking with a very successful Silicon Valley entrepreneur. Who's a man of the left. He's been a Democrat his whole life. And he was expressing complete bewilderment. Where is all of this vicious anti-Semitism on the left coming from? Whether it's in the squad in Congress or whether it's on college campuses. And I explained, I said, look, if you look at, and the book Unwoke explains this, Marxist, it started out with Karl Marx writing the Communist Manifesto. And he had a worldview that the world is in constant conflict, and it's in constant conflict between oppressors and victims. And Marx viewed things in a socioeconomic lens, and so the oppressors for Marx were the owners of capital, and the victims were the proletariat, the working men and women. And the solution that Marx advocated for was the violent revolution of the proletariat, of the victims, to overthrow the oppressors and use government to forcibly redistribute the wealth. Now, what I describe in the book is how Marxists starting in the 1960s began infiltrating the universities and becoming tenured professors, becoming administrators. And from there, we saw Marxism begin to mutate. It started off just plain vanilla Marxist. Then it mutated on other axes. So you had, for example, the same frame of oppressor-victim, but they shifted it to race, and that's where critical race theory came from. Same idea, constant battle, but based on races. They shifted it to gender and sexual orientation and gender identity. That's where things like queer theory came from. And what I explained to this fellow I was talking to is I said, look, what is happening is very simple. For the radical left, they have coded Jews as oppressors. And they have coded Palestinians as victims. And therefore, for a cultural Marxist, they support the violent revolution of the so-called victims against the so-called oppressors. It is part of what's been indoctrinated. And you look at universities, at these leftists who are radically protesting in support of terrorists who are committing atrocities that are unspeakable. That is a manifestation of the sickness that has taken over our institutions.
Well, do you distinguish between opposition to Zionism and anti-Semitism, or do you believe that those are the same thing?
I think anti-Zionism is anti-Semitism.
What do you say to so many different Jewish groups who say that they are anti-Zionist?
So the ones that are radical leftist organizations that look, there are 50-some-odd Muslim nations on the face of the planet. There's one Jewish nation, the State of Israel. The modern State of Israel was formed coming out of World War II, coming out of the wake of the Holocaust, and it was formed on the premise that never again means never again, that we would not allow 6 million Jews to be exterminated by genocidal racist maniacs. I think the Jewish people deserve to have a homeland. That is theirs. Israel was historically a Jewish nation going back thousands of years. I've walked in the city of David. I've walked on the streets where Jesus walked down the streets. And anti-Zionists, look, when you see leftists chanting from the river to the sea, that means from the Jordan River to the sea. It literally means obliterate the modern state of Israel because they hate Israel and they want to eliminate the only Jewish nation in the world that is racist and genocidal. Now, you asked earlier, would I ban that statement? No. I'd allow people to say it. You know, members of the squad have tweeted out from the river to the sea. But the answer, I'd allow them to say it, but I wouldn't sit there quietly. I'd point out that you are calling for, once again, the extermination of millions of Jews.
As I'm sure you know, though, in Likud's platform, it says, you know, from the river to the sea, there will only be Israeli sovereignty. You know, are they suggesting genocide of all Palestinians?
Of course not.
Exactly. So if they're not, why is the other suggesting genocide?
Because that's what Hamas supports. You know, I started yesterday morning.
But that's just restating it. Like,
but hold on. Let me say, yesterday morning, I started the day by watching a 46-minute video of the actual atrocities that Hamas committed. And about 50 senators watched it. As you guys know, I do a podcast every week. It's called Verdict with Ted Cruz. I do it Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. Today's podcast is all about that video. Because yesterday morning, and right about this time, I sat in a room and I watched 137 people be murdered. And most of the footage was taken from body cams or cell phones that the Hamas terrorists were carrying. And they were gleefully murdering civilians. They were murdering women. They were murdering children. And look, Hamas, I got to say the most disconcerting thing, I turned 53 in December. In 53 years of life on this planet, I've never had a day where I watched 137 people be murdered. That's what I did yesterday. And when you watch people, the most disturbing thing was the joy, the glee from these terrorists. I'll tell you, there was a moment on the video where one of the Hamas terrorists called his parents, and the Israelis intercepted the call.
Mm-hmm. Right. And we've heard of this one, yeah.
And he calls his dad, first of all, and he says, "Dad, I killed 10 of them with my bare hands." And he's like so proud and he's celebrating. 10, I killed 10. And he said, "I want to talk to mom. Can I talk to mom?"
Yeah.
And his mom gets on and he says, "I killed 10 Jews. I murdered them with my bare hands." And she begins crying with joy. The twisted hate. Can you imagine calling your mother in celebration that you just murdered 10 people and you're proud of it and your mother is proud of you for doing it?
And I know Emily wants to get a question, but I just, on this point real briefly, whenever we've had critics of Israel on, we've kind of insisted that they condemn that, because while we disagree with a lot on the show, we also try to find kind of moral common ground. And we can all agree that those types of atrocities need to be fully condemned. And with that in mind, I want to read to you a couple of things that we've been hearing from the Israeli government. We've had Defense Minister Gallant. "We will eliminate everything." An IDF spokesperson: "Our focus is on damage, not on precision." Agriculture Minister Avi Dichter: "We are now rolling out the Gaza Nakba. Gaza Nakba 2023. That's how it'll end." Israeli Heritage Minister Amichai Lau-Lavie said a nuclear bomb is, quote, "one of the possibilities." Finance Minister Bezalel Smotrich: "We need sterile zones in the West Bank." Israeli President Isaac Herzog: "It's an entire nation out there that is responsible. This rhetoric about civilians not aware, not involved, it's absolutely not true. They could have risen up. They could have fought against that evil regime." Another former Knesset member: "There is one and only solution, which is to completely destroy Gaza before invading it. I mean destruction like what happened in Dresden and Hiroshima without nuclear weapons." Would you join us in condemning that as well?
So I condemn nothing that the Israeli government is doing. I stand with the people of Israel. And let me explain. There is a qualitative difference. The Israeli government does not target civilians. They target military targets. The Israeli government
has— Why are they so bad at their targeting then, if they're killing so many civilians?
So they're actually not. They are—
So then they are targeting.
No, they're exceptionally good at— So for example, a couple of weeks ago, we had stories all over the world that Israel bombed a hospital in Gaza and killed 500 Palestinians. Now, it turns out that was a blatant lie. It was Hamas propaganda. And if you break down, literally every element of the story was a lie. So number one, Israel doesn't target hospitals.
Why have so many hospitals been targeted?
Because they haven't. Because it's fault. Let's actually look at the facts. So Israel uses precision-guided munitions. They don't target hospitals. What ended up, we discovered, was the case. It was the hospital. It was not an Israeli missile that took it out. It was a rocket from— it actually wasn't Hamas. It was Palestinian Islamic Jihad. And you got to understand, the terrorists in Gaza, they fire thousands of rockets. They have no guidance systems on them. So they literally put rockets. The rockets have some propulsion. They have an explosive. They have typically ball bearings or nails or something designed to kill as many people as possible. And they fire them in the general direction of Israel. But they can't steer them. Once they fire them, and about 20% of them end up hitting Gaza. So it's the terrorists that are actually bombing Gaza. So it was a terrorist missile that hit, but number one, it wasn't from Israel. Number two, it didn't hit the hospital, it hit the parking lot. Number three, 500 people were not killed. All of that was a lie, and yet what happened, and I talk about this in the book.
But that's
journalism. So I can tell you, there is no military on the face of the planet, including the U.S. military, that goes to the lengths that the Israeli military does to avoid civilian casualties. So I'll give you.
But the IDF said our focus is on damage, not on precision.
Yes, damage to Hamas, to terrorists, and I am all for.
They have said the opposite. They keep saying that's what they're doing is what they're intending to do, and here in the United States we say that's not what they're doing.
Simply not true. They are targeting the
terrorists.
Are they lying? No. My focus is on damage. Good. Damage Hamas. I want to utterly eliminate Hamas. And I'll tell you something Israel does, for example. So why are there Palestinian civilian casualties? The reason is because Hamas uses human shields. Hamas wants Palestinians killed. Look, you look at the Hamas headquarters, it's in the basement of a hospital. They put it in the basement of a hospital. Why?
But they didn't find it there.
They put it there because they want Palestinian mothers, children killed. They put missiles in kindergartens. And the reason is, it's part of my podcast. I did an entire podcast that was entitled, CNN is Hamas's Air Force. So is MSNBC, so is ABC. And I went through about a dozen stories where the corporate media just repeated Hamas propaganda. And look, Hamas is not strong enough to defeat Israel, but they're counting on the useful idiots in the media amplifying their messages. So I'll tell you something that the IDF does. So for example, if there's a building that they know they're Hamas terrorists in, they will drop initially what are called dud bombs. They'll drop a bomb on the top.
They've done this in previous wars.
That doesn't have an explosive, and the dud bomb will thud on the roof. Yeah. And they do it to tell the civilians, get out.
Right.
They by the way, they have every cell phone in Gaza, so they will text civilians, leave. By the way, when Palestinian civilians try to leave, Hamas keeps them there. They want Palestinians to die because it is useful for propaganda. There's no military. By the way, the U.S. military, when we're attacking our enemies, we don't drop dud bombs telling people to evacuate. Well, it's only the IDF that does that.
And so on that note, because we have to wrap, hot conflict now in the Middle East again. Is it time to endorse Donald Trump, negotiator of the Abraham Accords?
Look, I will say, President Trump, we had peace in the Middle East, and Joe Biden inherited peace and prosperity. And he utterly screwed it up. We went from peace and prosperity. We now have two wars. We have the biggest war in Europe since World War II. We have the worst war in the Middle East in over 50 years. And it's because having a weak and ineffective commander-in-chief is a train wreck. It doesn't work. And so, listen, we're wrapping up, but I do want to encourage your viewers. The book is designed number one, it's interesting and fun. It's filled with stories. It's not some abstract academic work. It's an interesting read. I want to encourage folks right now today, pull out your phone, go online, go to Amazon, go to Barnes & Noble, go to Books A Million, buy the book. And I'll say this, look, Christmas time is coming. So I'm going to encourage you, buy more than one. And in particular, it makes a great Christmas present.
Buy one for Ryan.
That's right.
Yeah, look. I mean, literally, buy one for your mom, buy one for your best friend, buy one for your crazy left-wing neighbor.
Cultural Marxism will triumph if we don't.
That's exactly right.
Don't let Ryan win.
Let me give you one more example, which is buy one for your kids or your grandkids, because they need to understand the poison that they're being indoctrinated for. And I wrote this book. I wrote this book for the same reason I do the podcast, that we've got to engage in the battle of ideas. We've got to engage in substance. And this book is designed to empower you to fight back, to take these institutions back.
Senator Ted Cruz, Republican of Texas, thank you so much for joining us.
We're being told you have to wrap. Welcome to come back again.
I look forward to it.
Great.
Thanks so much.
Hey, if you liked that video, don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to Breaking Points.
If you want to see the rest of Counterpoints, go to breakingpoints.com to become a premium member and get the full uncut show every morning in your inbox and on Spotify.
Help us build independent news and get the full show every morning at breakingpoints.com.